Hi, hello, what's up? MJC is right back here. I hope you've missed us. Here we are, MJC News, the place where we share with you the most interesting news from the Java world and beyond. My name is Alexei, and no more waste of time. Keep your smile and let's go. On 1st of June, AWS announced the general availability of Amazon EMR Serverless, a serverless deployment option for customers to run big data analytics applications using open source frameworks like Apache Spark and Hive without configuring, managing, and scaling clusters or servers. With EMR Serverless, you can run analytics workloads at any scale with automatic scaling that resides resources in seconds to meet changing data volumes and processing requirements. EMR Serverless automatically scales resources up and down to provide just the right amount of capacity for your application, and you only pay for what you use. Amazon EMR provides various deployment options to run applications to fit varied needs, such as EMR clusters on Amazon Elastic Compute Cloud, Amazon EC2, Amazon Elastic Kubernetes Service Clusters, Amazon EKS, AWS Outposts, or EMR Serverless. Also, when you build an application using an EMR release, for example, a Spark job using EMR release 6.4, you can choose to run it on EMR cluster, EMR or EKS, or EMR serverless without having to rewrite the application. This allows you to build applications for a given framework version and retain the flexibility to change the deployment model based on future operational needs. In our previous video about Java 2022 trends, we suggest that cloud and serverless would be a trend, and now you can see that even big data moves towards serverless computation. That's awesome! Okay, it's been 3 months since the JDK 18 release. Quite a lot, but, you know, MJC servers was down, the latency was a bit high, so don't worry. First of all, it is a first release after Java 17, which was LTS release. That means that you most likely will not update to this version, but it doesn't mean you shouldn't check new features. So, what's new? Deprecate finalization for removal in future release. Finalizers has flaws that cause significant real-world problems in security, performance, reliability, and maintainability. It also has a difficult programming model. If you are using finalizers, it's time to stop doing this. A bit later, it won't be possible. A second preview of pattern matching for switch, in which the Java language would be enhanced with pattern matching for switch expressions and statements, along with extensions to the language of patterns. This feature comes from Project Ember. The re-implementation of core reflection with method handles. Having method handles serve as the underlying mechanism for reflection will reduce maintenance and development costs of both the Java lang reflect and Java lang invoke APIs. A simple web server proposal. It is a simple command line tool which starts a minimal web server that serves static files only. The tool will be useful for prototyping, ad hoc coding, and testing practically in educational contexts. Specifying UTF-8 as the default charset of the standard Java APIs. Through this change, API that depends on default charset will behave consistently across all implementations, operating systems, locales, and configurations. For the whole list of changes, follow the link in the description. Additionally, let us know in the comments whether are you going to migrate to JDK 18. Last week, Sonartype discovered multiple Python packages that not only exfiltrate your secrets, AWS credentials and environment variables, but rather upload those to a publicly exposed endpoint. These packages were discovered by Sonartype's automated malware detection system, offered as a part of Nexus platform products, including Nexus Firewall. On a further review, we deemed these packages malicious and reported them to PyPI. These malicious packages are Loglib models, PyG models, PyGrata, PyGrata utils, HKG sol utils. For example, the Loglib models package contains malicious code. A script from this package fetches data from EC2 instance metadata service, collects AWS credentials, network interface information, and environment variables, and then attempts to upload this data to one or more endpoints hosted on the PyGrata domain. Researchers noted The endpoint collecting these credentials were exposing this data to just about anyone on the web. SonarType reported all those packages, including the problematic PyGrata utils, PyGrata and others, to the PyPI security team out of caution, and these packages were taken down. By the way, we had an interview with security engineer, you can check this link. Do not forget to watch it when you have time, since this topic is really meaningful. Spring Boot 2 was published on February 28th of 2018. Spring team have just released Spring Boot 2.7, which means that so far it has been maintaining the 2 line for just over 4 years. In total, 95 distinct releases have been published over that time frame. The entire Spring team and many in community of contributors are now preparing for the next generation of Spring. Spring Boot 3 is the planning to be released in November 2022. This next major revision will be based on Spring Framework 6 and will require Java 17 or above. It will also be the first version of Spring Boot that makes use of Jakarta EE 9 API's Jakarta package instead of Java EE 8 JAVAX package. The next 6 months offer an ideal opportunity to prepare your own project for this major release. Spring team has already prepared some guidelines which you can follow today to make any future migration as painless as possible. The list of actions includes upgrading to Java 17, upgrading to latest Spring Boot 2.6 version, checking for calls to deprecated code, and some additional steps. We will leave original link in the description. Make sure you don't miss it if you are going to use Spring Boot 3 eventually. Kotlin 1.7.0 has been released. It unveils the alpha version of the new Kotlin JVM K2 compiler, stabilizes language features, and brings performance improvements for the JVM, JS, and native platforms. Here is a list of the major updates in the version. The new Kotlin K2 compiler is in alpha now, and it offers serious performance improvements. It is available only for the JVM, and none of the compiler plugins, including Kapt, work with it. A new approach to the incremental compilation in Gradle. Incremental compilation is now also supported for changes made inside dependent non-Kotlin models, and is compatible with Gradle. We've stabilized opt-in requirement annotations, definitely non-nullable types, and builder interface. There is now an underscore operation for type args. You can use it to automatically infer a type of argument when other types are specified. This release allows implementation by delegation to an inline value of inline class. You can now create lightweight wrappers that do not allocate memory in most cases. For more details about each feature, you can check the release page by the link in the description. A security researcher from EthanWorks has discovered a vulnerability in the smart tap system, which is designed for remote control on Jacuzzi hot taps. As a result, he was able to gain remote access to bathrooms around the world. The smart tap system allows you to adjust the temperature in the Jacuzzi brand hot tubs, as well as change the filtration models and water level. The researcher found out that during authorization in smart tap, the admin panel appears on the start screen for a moment. Then he downloaded the JS file and changed a few lines of code. The researcher noted that on smarttap.io, a single page application created using React. He downloaded a JavaScript package and searched for unauthorized instances. The application checks whether the user is an administrator, but if this is not the case, it is redirected to the isadmin check. The login works by sending the username and password to the auth0. If successful, access and ID tokens are returned. Then the access token is sent to the auth0 user info endpoint, and this information is returned. It contains a list of roles, and isadmin checks if there is an admin there. But the HTTP response can be intercepted to add the missing administrator role. The researcher used Fiddler to modify the HTTP response accordingly and was finally able to gain full access to the admin panel. As the author of the work points out, theoretically, an attacker can remotely turn on the victim's Jacuzzi heating to the maximum or change the filtration cycles. Moreover, this exploit gives access to the personal data of all users, including their names, surnames, and email addresses. The specialist also hacked the SmartTap application for Android, discovering the URL that gave him access to the additional admin panel in the APK file. The researcher repeatedly tried to contact the Jacuzzi company to report the vulnerability, but he was first asked to send even more data and then just ignored. However, he found out that the vulnerability was eliminated by June 2022. At the same time, the Etonworks employee says that he knows about other errors, so he asked the Jacuzzi employees to contact him anyway. Amazon CodeWhisperer, a mail-powered coding companion. Trained on the billions of lines of code and powered by machine learning, CodeWhisperer has the goal to make your code simpler. Whether you are a student, a new developer, or an experienced professional, CodeWhisperer will help you to be more productive. It has been launched in preview form with support for multiple IDEs and languages. To get started, you simply install the proper AWS IDE toolkit, enable the CodeWhisperer feature, enter your preview access code, and start typing. CodeWhisperer will continually examine your code and your comments and present you with syntactically correct recommendations. The recommendations are synthesized based on your coding style and variable names and are not simply snippets. CodeWhisperer uses multiple contextual clues to drive recommendations, including the cursor location in the source code, code that precedes the cursor, comments, and code in other files in the same project. You can use the recommendations as is, or you can enhance and customize them as needed. As was mentioned earlier, AWS team trained and continue to train CodeWhisperer on billions of lines of code drawn from open source repositories, internal Amazon repositories, API documentation, and forums. It is a good opportunity to try such fancy tool and provide your feedback on it. You can check the details on the following link in the description. On 22 June 2022, the 123rd ECMA General Assembly approved ECMAScript 2022 language specification, which means that it's officially a standard now. Yay! What's new in ECMAScript 2022? The first one is new members of classes. This includes the following. Properties, aka public slots, can now be created via instance public fields and static public fields. Private slots are new and can be created via private fields and private members or accessors. Additionally, static initialization blocks have been added. The second one is top-level await in models. Error and its subclasses now let us specify which error caused the current one. Method add of indexable values let us read an element at given index. Object has own provides a safe way to check if object has an own non-inherited property with given k. And many more. This list is not a complete one. It is better to check the original news if you are interested. So check out the description and follow the link. JEP 428, Structured Concurrency Incubator, has been promoted from proposed to targeted status from JDK 19. Under the umbrella of Project Loom, this JEP proposes simplifying multi-threaded programming by introducing a library to treat multiple tasks running on different threads as an atomic operation. As a result, it will streamline error handling and cancellation, improve reliability, and enhance observability. This is still an incubating API. This allows developers to organize their concurrency code using Structured Task Scope class. It will treat a family of subtasks as a unit. The subtask will be created on their own threads by forking them individually, but then join it as a unit and possibly cancel it as a unit. Their exceptions or successful results will be aggregated and handled by the parent task. The benefits structured concurrency brings are numerous. It creates a child-parent relationship between the invoker method and its subtasks. As a result, the whole block of code becomes atomic. It ensures observability by demonstrating task hierarchy in the thread dump. It also enables short circuit in error handling. If one of the subtasks fails, the other task will be cancelled, if not completed. If the parent task thread is interrupted before or during the call of join method, both forks will be automatically cancelled when the scope exists. This brings clarity to the structure of the concurrent code, and the developer can now reason and follow the code as if they read through as if they are running in the single-threaded environment. So, like this video, if you are looking forward for JDK 19 release, I will definitely do this. And that's it! It's all the news which we would like to share with you. Hope you enjoy it! Thus, do not forget to like this video and subscribe. See you soon. Cheers.